Father, we love you, God. I pray that your spirit just pours over this room, Lord, and our hearts, God, just align with yours, Father. I pray that you speak to us today, Lord. I pray that in Jesus' name, we love you today. Amen.
Chest. Wow. Awesome. Good morning.
Good morning.
I consider it such a great privilege to be here with you guys. Just curious, I know this is a one-year course, but I was here last year. But I don't know if anyone kind of ran over each other or not. Like, I was talking to Zach, right? And then he said he got here in August, so who's been here since, like, who started with Zach, basically? Who's second semester?
Yeah,
like,
actually, yeah.
And then first semester was the newbies?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, yeah. Awesome. Just over you. I sanctify you. I'm happy. Just joking. Little Bible college humor, right? Love it. All right, yeah, so I'm not Pastor Trent. Trent's been doing your missions class, yeah? How's that been? How many of you would say you come from a missions-minded church? Missions-minded, like let's define that. Like, you guys go to Mexico, you guys are involved in local outreach, you guys are, you know, ministering to your neighbors, and then that goes to the nations, kind of. I would say that's missions-minded. Yeah, for sure. We don't really cross the seas, but, you know, we do cross the freeway, right? Yeah, that's cool. That's dope. That's really awesome. That's really awesome. And in a class like this, it's really good for you to be exposed in that way to some of the areas of the world. And so that's kind of really what we're happy to be here for. And so, sorry, my name is Aaron, and that's my wife, Jenna.
Hi.
And that is our little baby Lily in the back. So, so yeah, you're getting the full, like, Nepali Indian experience. And babies in church, you know, full on, like, running around, no diaper and everything. It's like, whoa, like, chaos, you know, chickens going in the class. So we've been full-time missionaries since we were 21 years old in the country of Nepal. So Jen and my, our testimony, we got married in January 2014, and we moved out to the mission field in February. So a month later, we moved, literally had just a stack of cash from, like, our reception. You know, you make off with the big bag, you know what I mean? You're just in the car and you're just like, wow. Like, with our wedding money, we moved to the mission field. And they didn't really have any partners, you know, like churches supporting us. We just sensed the call of God to be involved in ministry. And so we've been out there for now 7 years. And during this whole COVID lockdown, the Lord's timing, we were able to come home and have a baby. So amazing, like literally, like I remember looking it up online, I'm like, man, there's like some like crazy flu. This kind of sounds like, you know, Planet of the Apes type stuff. You know, it's kind of taking over everything. We should probably. And then Jenna tells me, like, hey, I'm pregnant. I'm like, whoa, like, you know, just overjoyed, you know, like. And then the next day, we got the call from the U.S. Embassy. They're like, hey, this is a pretty big deal. You should probably head back to the United States. So, but God's timing in that, right? Mm-hmm. And being here for way more longer than I'm used to. So we're actually getting ready to go back out in April. So invite you to come with. You know, come and serve with us. So type of ministry we're involved with. This our new missionary, right? that's for her passport, right? It's crazy to me that's good for 5 years. Like, in 5 years, she can be blonde, like, you know what I mean? Like, the same kid. Anyways, and so why Nepal, why India? And I'm going to mention also Pakistan, which is the newest branch of where the Lord's called us. Because it's really this 1040 window that we're talking about. You heard the 1040 window?
Just last class,
great. You're going to get rocked in a few weeks learning about the statistics of just even what goes on in 1040. I wonder if I can, my tech man standing by, I wonder if I can pull up these statistics. Okay, I can.
Yeah, all right. It'll explode, wait.
It'll explode. Okay, so typically, I mean, I know this is a poor map, but this is the United States, right? In the United States, there's something around 507 different diverse ethnic people groups. And 85 of them remain that still need the gospel. I mean, that's crazy, right? Mm-hmm. Total population is there, but Christian adherence, I mean, quote unquote Christian, 77.5%. Evangelical being 26.7%. These are the statistics from Joshua Project, you can get them there. But the average evangelical growth rate, 0.8%. What are we gonna do about that? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Do we need missions? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, I'm not really mission. Okay. Scratch the name missions. I'm not a missionary. Scratch the name. Do you believe that the Bible has called us for the evangelization of the world and the edification of the world? What am I talking about? Reaching the people and teaching the people. You think we're called to that? Well, then right on. We're in agreement here. Whether you do that to your neighbors, whether you do that to the nations, like, that's our calling. That's what we're going to talk about. So, what, all right, so stick this thought in your mind, right? 77.5% Christian adherence, right? Let's look at Nepal, for example. You see these red dots? Each one of them represents a tribe, a people group that has never heard the gospel. They say within the 1040 window alone, it's something like 350,000 people die a day in that area, never hearing the gospel message. 350,000 a day. That's every time your heart beats, 350,000 per day. Never hearing, never knowing, no access, no churches, no Bibles, nothing. So that's Nepal. And you see 1.3% Christian adherence. But look at the evangelical annual growth rate, 5.3%. A couple years ago, Nepal was on pace with China per percentage, right? For the fastest growing Christian nation. When Jesus says the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few, that's what we're talking about. So many places, so many areas of the world. That's just one country. Tiny country. Anyone from Arkansas? Nepal's the size of Arkansas. All right? It's a tiny little country. Only 285 different people groups. And 275 still in the gospel. That's why we're there. Right? Reach them, teach them, send them, plant them. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Let's look at this is just introduction, you know. Let's look at India. See the red dots?
Mm-hmm.
1.3 billion people never hearing the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
So in this 1040 window that we talked about, there's 3 billion people in the world. 3 billion people just in there. 8 billion now, like world, right? About half of the percentage lives in this 1040 window. 1.3 billion of them are in India alone, never hearing the gospel. How could that happen? Like, aren't there people? Aren't there? Very difficult, right? Christian adherence, 2%. 2%. Average evangelical growth rate, 3.9. Wow. Unreached people groups, this is the one that gets me. 2,445 unreached people groups. Does God want you to go? I don't know. I don't know if God wants you to go. But I want to break you. I want the Lord to break you. Oh, no, I'm supposed to stay. Right? No. The answer should be, Lord, do you want me to stay? Because the need is so great, right? God, you better make it clear, crystal clear, that I'm supposed to stay. Because we got to go.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And if you're not going, well, in some capacity, can I go, or can I pray, or can I send, right? Can I be a part of, you know, a church planting movement, like, out there, you know what I'm saying? Something, right? Pakistan, this is the one that really gets me. All right, again, there's less dots. There's more desert, though, right? So just keep that in mind. So 512 total people groups, 504 get unreached. That's 98.4% of the population. Never hearing the gospel. 98.4, never hearing the gospel. People dying every day, heading to eternal judgment. Christian adherence, 0.9%. So this is the area of the world and that the Lord has really given me a burden for, given us a burden for. The 1040 window that we talked about. Why the 1040 window? Because there's until the time where I was ready to, you know, receive it. Never hearing, guys. So the Lord has been gracious to us and allowed us to set up hubs and bases throughout this area. If I were to add another flag, there would be another one in Pakistan, because that's the heart. The Lord has given us an open door in this South Asia area. It's not easy, it's difficult, right? There's typical, like pressure from culture, Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism. Like, these are strongholds of these areas. But guys, if the Lord could use a few 21-year-olds with no experience, no training, no money, right? God can use you guys. Here's a quick video just to kind of, we made this when we were about 5 years in, so it's a little bit older, but still kind of hammers the point through. So this is some of what the Lord allowed us to do just in the first 5 years. All authority, I'll be with you all the days, and what hangs? Teach them to observe all that I commanded you, the three O's. Teach them to observe, not just teach, teach to observe, right? A patience that's involved, right? We're teaching Lily, right, to sleep through the night. Is that a one-time thing? But no, it took months, right? Teach them to observe it, teach them to keep it, right? Teach them to practice it, right? Pretty soon it's gonna be potty training time. Is that gonna be a one-time, like, hey, like, listen, I'm really a teacher, you know? No, that's not what it's about. It's about spending and being spent. Paul said this, he told this in the Corinthians. He says, I would gladly spend and be spent with joy for your souls. I will spend myself. At the end of 2 Timothy, he's saying, I've been spent, I've been poured out. And there's a crown laid up for me in heaven. Guys, you want to spend your life? Do you want to spend it? Well, I encourage you, you will. But you can either spend it in an investment, or you can spend it and waste it. You know what I'm saying? Guys, here's a missionary opportunity for you. Go make disciples wherever you go. Wherever you go. Stop waiting for someone to appoint you. Stop waiting for, like, a grand opportunity, a cloud to open in the sky. Like, oh yeah, my pastor's going to recognize me, you know? Angel over there looking smooth, you know, like, my pastor's gonna recognize this going on, you know, and it's just like, yeah, and we can wait on man, but I can take the command of Christ seriously. The resurrected Christ that had all authority told his disciples to go and make disciples. And we're gonna talk about making disciples today. That's our topic today. But this is how it worked out for us, right? Same calling, different doors, right? How could you work in India and Nepal and in Pakistan? Because we made disciples there. Mm-hmm. Now they're the ones leading the ministry, essentially, right? Calvary Chapel style, right? Balance, spirit and truth, not like anything crazy, not anything weird. Mm-hmm. Like, you'll see a lot of things, but anyways. But that's the vision, that's the calling that God's given us. Evangelize, discipleship, send, and then visit, encourage them. Right? So that's what the Lord's allowed us to do, share the gospel in these areas, discipleship. This is Pastor Raju. He was a student in our college in Nepal. That's part of discipleship. We set up Bible colleges. So we have several in India, but we have one in Nepal, and working on Pakistan. But that's the heart, is to disciple nationals that know the language, know the culture. They don't need a visa, right? They can't be kicked out of the country, right? We will, right? Raise them up, and then look what follows. This was a baptism that they just did. Raju lives, and I'm going to hopefully share with you the video today. He lives in basically the gateway of the Himalaya Mountains in Nepal. Like, cold, but beautiful, right? Like, super cold, super high up in the mountain. I'm going to share with you the video, but he goes up there, plants a church, and immediately fruit. Immediately, guys, getting saved out of Buddhism. And this was the baptism that he just had. How did Raju make a connection with them? He served in their fields. Some of these women are widows. Obviously, some of them are elderly. Their kids have gone and they've worked such and such a job or whatever. So what did Raju do? He said, I might as well go work in their field. Help plow, help plant, help harvest, right? And the Lord opened the door to their heart. In this completely Buddhist context, that's what it takes. Because they have no understanding of Jesus. You have to show them. You have to be willing to live and die with them in order to share the gospel. This is a frontier missions group, guys. Imagine, there's no biblical basis. There's no idea of, like, our Judeo-Christian anything, right? So it takes an investment, right? So, and then here's the fruit. And the Lord's allowed us to plant something over, you know, around 30 churches, like, in this area. Guys, just 7 years. How do you do that? You make disciples. And then you teach them, you train them, you send them. I'm not going to collect them. Why would I collect them? To build my kingdom, right? To build a big church? The name of Calvary Chapel would be known? No. Right? That they would go out. Preach the gospel. They would make disciples. And we're not dissecting them. sometimes we think of the word make disciples, but we dissected it in two halves, you know what I'm saying? How does that work? Well, if I were to ask you making disciples, what does that mean? It means discipleship, right? Obviously. But how do you get disciples of all nations where there is no disciples in those nations? There is no believers in those nations. So it's not just Bible study, but it's going out and sharing the gospel as well. You ever hear that? I don't know if you've ever heard that. And maybe even there's a pull on us as Calvary Chapel. We're such great Bible teachers. We're such great Bible students. Like, we're saturated in the Word of God, that we're not hitting the streets. And we're not going home to home as much. And if you're going to be in ministry, that's going to be honestly, that's going to be the struggle. Is you're going to be stuck in the church. You're going to be busy, so busy ministering. And I've been there. I'm not judging the way I've been there. You're going to be so busy ministering that you're neglecting the ministry. Reach, preach, teach, right? How are they going to come to the church? Oh, yeah, because we're Calvary Chapel. We just opened the door. The dove is up, you know? Build that they will come. No. Teach them, they will come. No. It should be teach them and they will go. Right? Because as we're going to learn, and as Trent's going to be talking about, what's the purpose of the church?
Make disciples,
right? Yeah. And let's define that, right? The purpose of the church, we exist to glorify God, right? To make disciples, to share the gospel, right? Remember the three E's. Exaltation of God, evangelization of the world, and the edification of the church, or establishing the saints. If we're to boil it down, well, what about Bible study and weekly service? No, that's the activities of the church, not the purpose of the church. Do we exist as a church just to have a Wednesday service? No. That's our huddle, right? That's where we get fueled up. That's where we get encouraged by the Lord, stirred up. That's where the woman that just got off of work comes in and her life is broken. That's where she gets the refreshment that she needs to go back to the mission field, which is her home. You know what I'm saying? The purpose of the church isn't just to have a church building. The purpose of the church is that we would reach the world and then disciple those that are saved, right? So don't dissect it, right? We often use discipleship as like a security blanket, right? Like, oh, I'm involved in discipleship, and you know, this is my safe zone, you know, and I'm teaching the junior high group, and that's safe for me, and that's cool. But if you're going to really make disciples with them, take them to share the gospel. Because now they need to experience that, right? If they're going to be a healthy disciple, they need to learn how to spiritually make disciples themselves, right? That's what we're going to talk about. So take them with you. Hey, we're just going to go grab some ice cream. All right, Zach, let's go. Let's go get some ice cream. And he's there with his boots, you know, pop, 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 you know, this and that. And we stroll in, and Zach's a little bit like, man, you know, this and that, you know. And then we're just sharing the gospel with the ice cream guy or whatever, you know. And then next time, Zach's like, dude, that was really cool. And I'm like, yeah, you should do it next time. And so that's a discipleship that's taking place. I'm sharing the gospel, but I'm also discipling him and sharing the gospel, right? It's not one or, either or. We like to do that, right? Just teach Christians, but who's going to reach non-Christians? It's a both calling, right? You might be especially gifted in one or the other. That's cool, but be balanced, right? That's what we learn at Calvary Chapel, right? We're not going to be crazy on one side. We're not Calvinists. We're not going to be crazy on the other side. We're Arminians, right? We're balanced. We're not going to be Baptist. We're not going to be Pentecostal. We're going to stick with the Word of God and the balance that it prescribes, right? I don't know what was supposed to go in this slide. Oh, there's the video. Let me show you what a local, a typical house church looks like. This is Hyderabad, India. So the third or fourth largest city in India. We have a Calvary Chapel guy that planted there. His name's Edward. And this is what a typical worship service looks like. that's definitely Indian, right? You know what I'm saying? So
in that demographic where you're showing, is it like, does the government want to get to this, or is all this kind of like?
It's very illegal. Oh. Very illegal. Very much illegal.
Praise God.
Praise God, right? So yeah, it's a, you're allowed to be a Christian, but you're not allowed to convert anybody. You're not allowed to be converted. If you convert, you have to go to the police station, and they might have a full investigation. Was your parent Christian? Who converted you? All this stuff, right? So oftentimes we're just going for it, right? Making these relationships, and so that when they're ready, they fully commit to Christ, and it doesn't matter what they face after that, because they made that decision. Here's the most recent church plant. This is in a little village called Itauta in Nepal. Like literally just a little village on the side of like a major highway, right? Big village. We had a student there, his name was Loxman. If you see Loxman, he's this dude right here. Loxman is here. Sarmila is the one chick with a mask, so it's easy to spot her, right? They planted during COVID. So they were part of our Bible college. They were third semester students, and everything shut down, so we're like, all right, go back and, hey, the school's shutting down, so we ran with it. Go, make disciples, commission them a little bit early, And they planted a church, so, oh, awesome. This is one of the faithful men that God has given to us to raise up and train. And his wife came along also. Like, they quit their jobs, everything, to come to Bible college. Mm-hmm. And we only got a year and a half through with them, and vamanos, let's go, what I'm saying? This is another story of a guy named Robbie. Robbie was literally, he was being called the reincarnation of Lord Buddha. Like, he went to Buddha's house, he stays like Buddha, like real, like Buddha. It was so much so, this is a newspaper article, it was a news station in Nepal. They're running like, hey, Buddha has appeared, he's the reincarnation, everything. People were literally coming down and worshiping him, mm-hmm. right? Like washing his feet with water and then drinking the water. Oh, like worshiping him, bro. And it's tricky because Buddhism and Hinduism, right? It's one lie that the same packages, right? Mm-hmm. It's one lie. But in Hinduism there's 300 million different gods. So everything's a god, everything's worshipped out there. Buddha can reappear at any time. So you see how the rules are subject to change all the time? So this guy's Buddha. What happens to Buddha? He gets very sick to the point where he's going to die. And his mom hears the gospel, gets saved. His mom goes to him and says, Ravi, I love you. Shares with him the gospel. He's like, I'm sick. I'm going to die. Come to church. So Buddha went to church. Ravi went to church. And what happened? Buddha got born again.
Wow.
Right? Buddha got born again. Isn't that crazy? That's the power of the gospel. Not us, his mom, sharing the gospel. Robbie comes to us, now as a Bible college student. Can you imagine Buddha's in your class? Like looking at me like weird, like, and he's tripped up. He's got all this weird stuff, right? You come to Bible college with a bunch of weird stuff? Yeah, you're good company, right? This dude's twisted inside. He's like learning everything for the first time. He was worshipped, now he's worshiping the true and living God. It's just so backward for him. First time we prayed for him, he fell down on the ground and he said he was demon possessed. We're like, dude, all right, we need to teach you, bro. It was just so much stuff, dude. So we trained him. He went to the 2-year course with him, and the Lord made him a man of the word, integrous, convicted, like in his soul. The Lord ends up opening with doors all over Nepal. And even to work, even to go and visit and share the gospel with Nepalis that are working abroad in different countries. Now, the Lord gave him a beautiful wife, and they planted CC Banyatar, which is a church plant in Kathmandu. Kathmandu is the largest city in Nepal. So he's on the far, far, what we would say, east side of Kathmandu. So he's there. What's up?
That sounds crazy.
Yeah, crazy, right? And he has such a massive Facebook following. Probably because he was Buddha at one point, right? And what does he do? He shares the gospel. He teaches them verse by verse study, right? Awesome. I told you about Raju. Remember the dude who was baptizing? Yeah, I showed you a picture of one, like one of the first pictures. So we visited his village, and he was another guy. He graduated, went back out, right? He was the guy that was working in the fields, helping the widows and stuff. So this next clip is a video of when we went to his village. Now, mind you, when I came to Nepal, my vision was this small, right? I kind of felt like the apostles when they were in Jerusalem. They're just in Jerusalem, right? But what did Jesus say? You're going to be my witnesses by the power of the Holy Spirit. You're going to take this from Jerusalem, where?
Samaria, to the end of the world.
Yeah. Bible book for both you guys, right? You guys still do Bible books? So like, no, you're going to take this gospel. And Jesus said, you're going to be my witnesses, right? But by the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember, we've always been given the Spirit to do the Lord's work. The power to do the Lord's work. It's not us. Like, I can't flex on you guys this morning and be like, yeah, this is all that we, this is a work of God's grace by His Spirit. So, what happened, our vision got shaken up. And the Lord was like, man, I want you to send out some guys, plant churches. One of the areas was this mountain area called Lapu. In the base of the Himalayas, right, the gateway of the Himalayas. This was our trip when we went out there. So just as a way of introduction, we had to drive 15 hours, and we're like on chocolate, like roads, like mud, skidding, everything, right, on the side of mountains. You're welcome to come next trip. Like, there's literally excavators, like, making the roads so that we can drive. Going through, and then we stop, and we're like, wow, finally we stop. And we're like, all right, we have to sleep here, acclimate to the elevation, and tomorrow morning we'll make the climb. How far is the climb? 7 to 8 hours. Stairmaster the whole way. Like, just getting it, you know what I mean? Like, it's like when you're at the gym, you put it on 10, you know what I mean? It's like, here's the video of when we got to go.
John 3:16.
Yes.
Romans
Jesu, tapaylai, prem, varnu huncha.
What is that?
Jesus loves you.
Oh, wow.
Wait. Jesu, tapaylai, prem, varnu huncha. I throw that in, bro. You're in, bro.
What does that mean?
It's just, they're local.
Bob.
Indians and Nepalese, we shake our heads.
Okay,
listen, guys, want to stay in touch with you guys as much as we can. So this very, this is an email sign up. So email or whatever, I mean, we're on Facebook, Instagram, everything, right? We don't have Snapchat, come on down. But please sign up, give me your name, your contact. We'd love to stay in contact with you. And then also, we have these, like, prayer cards. Stuff from your Bible, like, we love, appreciate your prayers. I have more cards. I didn't want to overwhelm you. I have more cards for all the pastors that we mentioned. So you can even take their cards as well. I even have a pastor in Pakistan. You can take his cards. Love for you to pray for him too. So love to give you those things too. Maybe we'll make them available for the next break. But yeah, grab something, sign up. Love to stay in contact with you, all right? Amen. Any other questions?
What's your Instagram?
Huh? Instagram, what's the Instagram?
Jenna Garcia.
So that's my wife's name.
It's like with those two little lines.
And we're posting stuff always. And the cool thing is if you put your email, you can get our like monthly blog update. We also post it on Instagram, so you can like type, like hit it, and then it'll take you to the website. You can always read up and stay in touch with us. But we love to stay in contact with you and also give you opportunities. All right? You're most welcome. Mm-hmm. Any place we can go. Yes, question.
How long did it take you guys to learn the law? I guess that would be like the craziest thing going on missions, like just like, and even like the craziest temptation of the devil, just like feel inadequate for not knowing the language, I guess. Like how did you overcome that?
We say typically it takes the first 2 years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Not only language, but also culture.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? Because like you know the word of God now, but you don't really know how it applies to their culture, their situation.
Yeah.
The word of God doesn't change, bro. Like, this is what's amazing. He's like, the word of God is for every culture. You can always, you know, you can always rely upon this. But how to apply that, you know? Like, husband should have one wife, right? Hey, you gotta have one wife. So the guy goes home and kills his other wives. Like, because he has six, right? Like, what do you do? Like, okay, then how do we take care of the other wives and not kill them? Okay, so then he just has a relationship with the first one, but then he's legally, he should support the other five. That's a real issue you have to deal with, you know what I mean? Like, so you know the word, but you don't know the application of it. So.
But it took us a while.
Did you learn the poly hands-on, or did you go take schooling before?
We had a teacher that provided help. But honestly, the best way is if you submerge yourself. So you're in a situation where your friends are talking to you, you're practicing what you're learning and stuff. So yeah. But I'm brown, bro, so it's hard. So I can get by. Jenna, my wife, is really brown. Like, we can get by. So Gabby is going to join us out there. She's brown.
We're still learning the language, but I mean, we've learned it. If we had the tutor come to our place, and so it was like about a year. But then there's just so much Nepali that we still are learning it even now. Like, we learn new words and things like that. But when the earthquake had happened, that was kind of like, we were kind of like shoved into being translators for teams that would come. So that was kind of like, here you go, like, fast course.
Any questions? Sorry.
Yeah, are they just getting the Bible from you, or do they actually have a Bible?
Yeah. So what you usually have in these places, they'll have like Wycliffe or some of these guys. You know you guys know Wycliffe?
Yeah.
Bible translators, right? They'll go and they'll give you like one base translation. But the problem is that language is it's like the national language, but it's not their mother tongue, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know how to compare it, but like it's like, I don't know, I guess.
So like Spain, Spanish, to James?
Yeah, typically, yeah, something like that, right? It's still Nepali, technically, but it's not their tribal language. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a lot of times you're using the Nepali Bible, and there might be people that don't read Nepali. Like, they don't, or India's crazier. Because you have Hindi, which is the national language, but there's like 1,000 languages in India? Like, ridiculous. Like, in the places we work, there's 5 different languages. So I taught the Book of Romans, and it was translated to 3 other languages. Dude, like, you would have to say something so carefully, because you wouldn't get it back for another 2 minutes. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, you know, just the information. Who did it? Whatever. I love it. Wow, it was just one word. You know, like, it was intense. But the hope is to cut out the middleman. You know what I mean? Give it to them in their language. Give it to them so they can understand it. They can teach it. And they can flow.
And these translators, do you, are they like people that you guys trust?
You've had to disciple them.
Okay.
Because you can't. It's hard to get a translator that doesn't know biblical theology. Because you could say something like, oh, Jesus wants to save you. They translate, okay, Jesus wants to heal you. So how many people you want to receive salvation? How many people do you want to receive healing? That's big out there. So now you got like 100 people receiving healing from your salvation. So the photo looks good, put it in the blog, but that's not what was said. So it's careful.
Could you tell us about your first month or year? Because you showed up with nothing, right?
Yeah.
And how long did it take you to get like established in the way?
Work. Yeah, man.
Work.
I would say the first 2 years was really our, it was our like training ground. It was like being taken out of the greenhouse where you're just growing, right? America, Bible College. You're in a greenhouse right now. Right? It's like accelerated everything, right? Then you can take it out to the ministry. And especially out there, it was like immediately like opposition, challenges. So like we went to be part of child sponsorship initially. Like Jenna would help out with child sponsorship, right? And then I would disciple some of the older kids and some of the older men that, you know, they come through the program and stuff. We end up going for a 3-month vision trip and the whole thing cancels. So that child sponsorship program, they felt like the ministry collapsed.
Wow.
So we were there with like a small team, I think 7 of us in total or 6 of us in total. And our heart was, we wanted to disciple. So we ended up having some friends because they, one of the couples that we were working with, they had been there for a couple of years. So they said, we've always wanted to start a Bible college, but we never had a team to do it. But we had to get a building, we had everything. It was like, we get this building, it's disgusting, dude. Like the first, I would say month, we're just cleaning. Like you're mopping the floor and it still looks black. But what an experience, right? But I remember, you know, when we weren't setting up that building, we would take villages trips. I remember we went out on one village trip and one lady received the gospel, right? Mm-hmm. And she says, hey, I want you to come to my house. And I want you to preach now to my whole family and my friends. She was like a rich lady, kind of like a, you know, kind of, her family had a fishing business. So they had these like awesome, like river black fish, dude. Like kind of like catfish looking things. Delicious. Anyways, so they had this business. And so they said, hey, come out and like, and preach. I'm like, yeah. I'm like, so we're riding the motorcycles out there, and it's like literally like wreck your neck, you know what I mean, for like an hour, like crossing bamboo bridges, all this stuff. Like my mind is being blown, right? But every village that I passed by, everybody's face was painted red for their God. Like the day before, I didn't know, but it was like a festival. So everybody just gets drunk and paints their face red and does all this craziness all night. Evil, demonic stuff. So I remember we drove, and mind you, I've only been here for a month, bro. Right? I'm getting wrecked. Like, I show up at this preaching spot, and I'm like, almost like a fear of, like, an inadequacy. Like, what am I even doing here? Like, my whole drive for like an hour or something, I saw nothing but red faces. Every single person that I saw, like those red dots on the map, that red, like I see red faces when I see that. like terrified. They're like, all right, all right. So we have a meal, and Nepali culture, we're eating for like 2 hours, bro.
You what?
We're eating for like 2 hours.
Really?
I remember eating so much fish that day, dude. I'm so sick.
Is it good? Is it good?
It's delicious, bro. Delicious. Right. So finally, they're like, all right, you stand up and preach it. And so I'm like, all right. And I had this like, you know, we're going to do this, right? Preach the gospel, and one little lady in the front row raises her hand. Like, one out of like, I remember being like, my gut response, that's it. Just one. Right? I went back home, went back late in my tent, and I remember just thinking, like, I could be here the rest of my life, and I would never make an impact. What are we going to do? And I remember I was going through the Bible, which is good. Right, it's good to read your Bible, right? Yeah, Bible knowledge. All right, we're done for today. right? Like, I remember reading that portion where Jonathan goes out with his armor bearer. Mm-hmm. It's just two of them. And he says something. He says, let's just go see what God's going to do. And he says, for the Lord can save by many, or he can save by few. Mm-hmm. God is not. He can do whatever he wants, whatever he chooses. And like, for a moment, I was like, looking at my wife, and I was just like, armor bearer right here, like, like she's got my back, right? We're just gonna go out, we're just gonna see what we're gonna do. And guys, and we're gonna talk about a lot today, the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit to open up doors like you wouldn't believe, man. When the earthquake happened, like entire villages were cut off. So there was a massive earthquake in Nepal. I don't remember if you remember that. It was like
16,
like 5 years ago or something, right? But like avalanches, but there was also like landslides, cutting off entire like mountaintop. Imagine like there's a village in the mountaintop nobody can get to. There's no roads, right? No supplies, no nothing. So, random, bro, random. We're praying, like, God, give us an opportunity. We want to, like, we feel burdened for these people. And we know people that have family out there. We're like, man, we could just go. We get a phone call. Missions Aviation Fellowship. You ever heard of these people?
No. Mm-hmm.
All right. They like have a helicopter ministry. And they're like, hey, like, we have a bunch of resources, a bunch of supplies. We even have fuel, but we don't have anyone to go. Mm-hmm. And we're like, are you serious? They're like, where do you want us to go? They're like, wherever you want, we'll fly you. I'm like, well, how much would they pay you? They're like, pay a little bit for the fuel, but it's like, it was like 98% subsidized. They pay for everything. We just have to go. I'm like, are you serious? So mind you, right, this is that moment where God's taking me out of Jerusalem, right, out of Kathmandu, just your Bible college, just your churches, you know, this and that. And he's taking us to the remote, to the ends, like, where Jesus said, I'm going to take you to the ends of the earth, right? We go in this helicopter, and we drop down, and everybody in the village comes out, and they all get blasted with sand in their face, you know, so funny. We drop down, and we come, and it's the festival of their God's birthday that day. Mm-hmm. Everybody's toast and drunk. I'm like, man, what is it with, like, you guys have, like, 300 million different gods, man? Every day is a birthday or whatever. You know? I'm like, dang, the one day we come. So we're like, yeah, everyone's too toasted. If we start open air, if we start going for it, they're going to kill us. You know? We go, we make camp, and then we just start, you know, going, we share the gospel here and there, like ones and twos, right? And then in the middle of the night, I'll never forget it, bro. All of a sudden, I start hearing drums. Boom, 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 boom. Bro, and they're getting louder. And there's a lot of drums. And now it's like kind of like Jumanji, like boom, ba-da, boom, ba-da, boom. I'm like, you know, I look outside my tent, and it's me and three other guys. I look outside my tent and I'm like, wow, we're gonna die. There's a long line of like flashlights coming from the top of the mountain and down. Like a line. And then nothing but drums and nothing but light. I can't. So we put on our boots, we put on our jackets, we get like our little MREs kind of thing, and we just made a plan. We said, if they attack us, just jump off the mountain and just roll. just hide. And the helicopter will be here in a few days, like, maybe, like, we'll escape or whatever, right? Because there had already been, like, some hostility or some other stuff that popped off. And we're just like, man. So, dude, we're all getting ready. And the drums are like, now you can tell there's a crowd of people, like, around us. Like, and all of a sudden, someone opens up our tent. And it's a guy with, like, a fancy hat. And he says, "We are the villagers. We have come to sing and dance for you." Dude, I almost fainted, bro. Like, my bed was right by the tent door. So I'm like looking up at him. He's like, I see it up his nose. Like, "We are the villagers." Thank you.
Oh my
God. We get out there, bro. And it was almost like set up, dude. Like, all the people are, like, gathered here, and there's, like, one rock. Perfect. Got up on the rock. Just like this, dude. I was touching on paraphrase. And my buddy, he says, "Hey, share the gospel with us." And I was like, "All right, you ready?" And just lay it all out, man. I think, like, just talk. Like, could have talked all night. But just, they wanted to hear what we had to say. And we said, "The God from the heaven has sent us here to talk with you. We share with you? Can we get to know you? Can we lay out the full gospel, man, from creation?" Spent like it seemed like forever. And at the end of it, we said, "And Jesus is offering you eternal life and forgiveness of your sins, and he can free you of all your shame and all that stuff, right?" And how many of you want to receive Christ? And everyone's like, you know? And then suddenly one old man. And then once an elder receives, anybody is free now. Because now they feel like, okay, an elder is like open, right? So the whole village that night was eager. Like, we were thinking, how are we gonna reach them? Like, going, the Lord brought them all to us. And then we spent the rest of like our days there just meeting with some of the young kids and discipling them. Finally, we met a guy that we sent to that region. So two guys that we trained, they went and they planted a church beside that, like the mountain beside that mountain. And they had outreach ministry there, like continuing the ministry. Now there's a church, and just crazy, like, all right, Lord, like, that's what you want to do today, you know? Mm-hmm. But it comes by way of saying, "I'm available for whatever you want to use me." So I encourage you guys, you know, they absolutely surrendered because Jesus bought you with his blood. Like, when Paul says you are not your own, you've been bought with a price, glorify God in your body. Mm-hmm. You are not your own. not your own anymore, right? But you lay down your life and you'll find it. You'll find it. And that's God's calling on your life, to go out and make disciples. Wherever you go, whether it's in the nations, whether it's right here, you don't have to wait for some appointment anymore. You don't have to wait for your church. You don't have to wait for your pastor to get sick and step out of the ministry to take over the church, right? Like, you don't need, like, oh, like, one day I'm going to lead the youth group, or like, these are things like that you wrestle with. I wrestled with when I was in Bible class. Like, man, somebody's going to give me an opportunity. You know what? The best people that are for ministry, the ones that are already doing it. When I was ordained, I was already doing me, right? Title, no title, nothing. I'm called to full-time ministry. I'm going to do this. So then it was like, oh, let's ordain this guy. Let's, like, we already thought you were a pastor. Well, the calling, right? So encourage you guys. Stop waiting for man's appointment. Recognize God has called you. So we'll talk more about that when we get back from break, right? All right. So very important announcement. Here's my wife. This is my wife. Oh yeah. This is my wife, Jenna.
Hi, Jenna.
Hi.
Hi.
Sorry,
thank you. Oh, thank you. So yeah, she can tell you from her perspective. She goes everywhere that I go, pretty much. And she's been amazing the whole way. Sometimes where I look at her, I'm just like, I'm sure glad I married right. way with the guys too.
Yeah, yeah.
Same with the guys. So you're zealous, you're here, like you're like, oh, like, and then you marry some like anchor. I mean, for real, it's, you know, that's why it's always just best to just wait on the Lord. And the Lord provide. You want to, yeah.
He's perfect.
Run, run your race. Run your race and marry the person that runs beside you, right? Church is a reflection of Christ. So if you look at my wife and she looks bitter, it's because her husband's a joke. Remember that. I'm not loving her. But when I love her, and this is what the Lord taught me, she becomes like a flower, like blooming, like I love her the way that she's supposed to be loved. And what happens is she becomes more and more beautiful over the years. Like just, wow, the giftings and everything and callings. And my wife is so good. She's never held me back. She's never, but I just have to make sure that I love her and I love the baby. And I'm really loving them. And we can flow. You know what I'm saying? So, but yeah, there's times where, you know, I'm afraid I'm gonna get arrested. And what happens with her? She's stuck in country. You know, and what if, you know, there are times where the police just show up at a place, you know, and they're questioning everyone, you know, why are you here? Who are you, you know, all this stuff. And we're there illegally. Kind of, in a sense, right? So those things. And so if you remember, pray for us for that, you know? Because you want to be bold and you want to be courageous, but you also want to be wise and take care of the family. So I know why I'm there. It's to preach the gospel, make disciples. So you don't ever want fear to become a snare in that way, hold you back. So, any questions?
Yeah, I was just wondering, like, how I always thought it is, like, a lot of people have an idea like love is like an emotion. Well, love is a choice. It's like you choose. You can love your enemy. You're not gonna particularly have emotions towards your enemy, you know. So like, how do you define loving your wife for the men of this group here?
Yeah, that's a good question. Mm-hmm. Jesus came to the world and died for the church. Mm-hmm. You can do that. You'd be good at it. Come to your wife's world. She's the weaker vessel, right? So 1 Peter 3 says, you should be acquainted with her, you should know her, right? You should live with her in an understanding way. Live with her. She's the weaker vessel. She's not this rough dude, right? She's not like Tupperware you can just kick around and it never cracks. She's like fine china, right? Easily cracking, right? And so what your job is to live and die for her. Not take a bullet, but be selfless. That's hard with men, right? We're the lone wolf, right? And we run, we do things, and that's just the way that I am. I'm Mexican, you know, this and that, right? I said it, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, then you're able to say, like, no, like, yeah, that's the way I am, but God has made us one. It's off. There's got to be some give and take. And go into marriage not to get, right? That's your expectations. Oh, I'm gonna get, you know. Guys have one expectation, what marriage is gonna be like, girls have another expectation. she's trying to give to me 100, 100, right? I'm only giving 50. Is she off the hook? Does she only have to give me 50 now? No, she's like, what's wrong, baby? Let me tell me what's wrong. I'm like, you're only giving me 50. Like, what? Does she like, right? That's the tendency, right? No, but the mature person, the one that wants to make the marriage last, is because we have a fear of God. You will never divorce if right? Obviously, like, there's extremes. Obviously, I'm not saying this, but if Jesus is your Lord, then your marriage issue isn't a marriage issue, it's a lordship issue. Lord, you told me. What God has brought together, let no man separate, right? So that word divorce never comes up in us, right? We make decisions together, right? I'm the head, but Jesus is my head. You know what I'm saying? So I'm accountable. Taking Jenna to all these crazy places, like, she was on that trek to the mountains, right? And so I'm accountable for sure. So definitely want to be in the spirit and right. That's why it's hard to be honest, for sure. But it's a blessing. It's a huge blessing. I couldn't do what I did without her. She's a perfect help for me. So,
love you.
Aww.
Let's actually teach the Bible. That's what we're here for, right?
Do you need more water?
Okay. I don't know if you can read this slide. It's not even, like, so we think, go therefore make disciples. How do we do that? That's the answer we're going to learn. Right? How do you do that? How do you make disciples? Like, obviously we talked about evangelization, right? How do you make a disciple when there are no Christians, there are no believers, right? In America, make disciples means go disciple another Christian, right? Take someone in the youth group, already a Christian, basically. But that's because we're saturated with Christianity. When make disciples was given, there were no disciples, there were no believers. So you weren't able to dissect make disciples into two categories. Evangelize, edify, right? We couldn't separate. Share the gospel, make a disciple. It was one and the same. Make a disciple, share the gospel, Mark 16, right? Preach the gospel to all creation. Luke says this gospel must go out, right? To all the world, baptism, repentance, right? All that stuff. Acts 1:8, you shall be my witnesses. By the power of the Holy Spirit, right? We need to go share the gospel. But the way that the Great Commission is going to be fulfilled is through making disciples. Mm-hmm. Why? Because it's multiplication. Mm-hmm. Evangelization alone is addition. Discipleship over the long period of your life is multiplication. It's exponential growth. It's I discipled you, or it's Jesus discipling Paul, right? Because Galatians 1 says that's where he got the gospel from, right? Paul disciples Timothy. Timothy disciples faithful men who will then teach others also. So Jesus is one, now it's going to be four. Mm-hmm. Right? It's multiplication. That's what we read in the book of Acts. Discipleship taking place. Make disciples, now teach them. And teach them to reach others also. Teach others also, right? That's what we're going to talk about today. But here are some examples. Titus 2:4. Let the older women train the younger women. Mm-hmm. But I'm not a disciple, I'm not a pastor, right? Older women teach younger women. That's making disciples. We're going to look at this passage, 2 Timothy 2:2. Paul trained Timothy to train others to train others. Ephesians 6:4. Fathers are to train their children. But I'm not a pastor. How can I do that? No. The Great Commission is for all of us, for Christians. Not pastors, not preachers, not teachers. Everybody, for a disciple. You're a disciple, make a disciple. Your church should be involved in planting other churches. That's what we see in the New Testament. Acts 28:20. This is what we get, right? Missionaries are to teach the nations everything Jesus commanded. Hebrews 3:13. All Christians are to exhort and to teach others every day to avoid sin and to stir up each other towards love and good works. And also it says that in Hebrews chapter 10. 1 Peter 4:10. All Christians are to use their gifts to serve one another. all Christians, right? You've been given this gift of God's grace, now use it, right? That's what Peter says. Acts 18, beautiful story, by the way. Acts 18, you guys remember the story of Apollos? He's this hot shot, silky preacher, right? You're like, man, Apollos, you're so eloquent, dude. He's preaching in the church, and there's this older couple, I imagine. You want to go with us to soup plantation after church? I don't know where you guys go after church, you know. Where do you guys go after church after here?
We're in Brooklyn this year.
We go here and we see.
Sorry about that. perfect. You want me to feel it, I'm sure. Right? Priscilla and Aquila, this powerful team, husband and wife, right? They say, hey, Apollos, can we meet with you after church? Can we take you out to lunch? And what does it say? They taught him the way of God more accurately. Discipleship. Understand? Who was Priscilla and Aquila? Tent makers? Apollos? Right? Disciple one another. You can be disciple to me. You can disciple your pastor. We disciple each other. We're mutually edification, right? What Paul says in Romans chapter 1. I want to encourage you, you encourage me, right? Can you imagine that? And what does it say about Apollos? He goes on to Ephesus, and he's used like powerfully. Like the Lord used his humility, poured out his grace to use him for an effective ministry. So how are we going to fulfill the Great Commission? Making disciples. Why? It's multiplication, not addition. Understand that? Don't just teach other Christians, but reach non-believers and teach them to reach others, to teach them, to reach them, to teach them. And the process goes on and on. So go to 2 Timothy chapter 1. This is Paul's farewell. Imagine Paul and Timothy have a minute, they have a relationship going back something like 16 years at this point. Timothy's not a young man, but he is the protege of Paul. Right? He's the understudy, right? If somebody happens to me, you're in, bro. You're going to fill my spot one day. Imagine Joshua and Moses type deal, right? And this is the word for you guys today. One of these days, right now even, faithful today for the opportunities of tomorrow, right? God is calling you. He's set you apart. He set you apart for this year of your life. And here's the word. Be faithful to what? Be faithful with which what God has entrusted to you. What has God given you guys? He's given you an undisturbed season of the Word of God. Mm-hmm. That is a treasure to which you've been entrusted with. Mm-hmm. And what are you going to do with it? Commit it to others also. Guard it, protect it, preach it, give it out, use it, right? That's what we're going to look at today. Starting in chapter 1, verse 13, he says this, hold fast now, hold fast to the pattern of sound words which you have heard from me in faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed to you, keep by the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. He starts off saying, hold fast. Hold fast. The word hold fast, it means to cling, to possess. Hold on to these things. Hold on to the pattern of sound words. Pattern means model, the example. So Paul's saying, I've laid down an example for you. An example of what? Sound words. Good, healthy doctrine, the Word of God. So he's saying, hold fast to these things, right? The Word of God, the gospel, which he talked about in chapter 1. Hold on now to these things. You've heard them from me. Notice he says in verse 13, in faith and in love, which are in Christ Jesus. So the Word of God is never void or separated from faith and love, right? We're not Pharisees. What an important lesson, right? For Paul to give to Timothy. Hold on to these things now. to them and become so cold that you lose faith and love. There's a fervency when it comes to the Word of God. There's a passion, right? A love, a faith towards God, a love, a faith to go out, right? You've heard it said, people don't know how, they don't care how much you know until they know that you care, right? Or something, I think I jumbled it up, right? You're gonna go back now. You're gonna hold fast to these things that you've been entrusted with. Hold on to them, cling to them, but don't forget the faith and love part. Timothy, you can't just run in and show up and expect to have an audience. Faith and love is gonna open those doors. Christ is gonna open those doors as you present Christ. And that's your job, right? You bring Christ to the people, and the Holy Spirit's job is to bring the people to Christ. I'm not a converter. I don't convert souls. You don't convert people. What do? We bring Christ. We bring faith. We bring love. We bring the Word of God. And notice it says this. Verse 14, that good thing. What's the good thing? The Word. The gospel, right? That good thing, verse 14, which was committed to you. Again, committed. That word committed, it means entrusted. You've been given something as a steward, right? Timothy, you've been given something as a steward. It's been committed to you. The word means deposit, actually. Like Paul was making a deposit, an investment into Timothy's life. He says, that good thing which was committed to you, deposited to you, verse 14, keep it by the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. Keep it by the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. Again, imagine Paul is, you know, he's headed off the scene. Pretty soon he's going to be gone. And what was Paul doing in all of his epistles? We know he was guarding the Word of God. Read Galatians, right? Read Philippians. He's like, hey, tell those women to stop fighting. You know, read, right, Romans, right? He's like, Jew and Gentiles, we're one. We're wrapped it in, right? He's always settling conflict. He's always dealing with issues. Corinthians, he's like, hey, love, that's good, but also we need holiness as well, right? We can't just, he's always settling up issues. So what does he say? Timothy, now you do that same thing. Now you guard it. That was entrusted to you, keep it, guard it, he's saying, by the Holy Spirit, right? The ministry that we do, it's not by might, not by power, but it's by the Lord. It's by the Holy Spirit. That's the power, right? Timothy, how's Paul's Timothy going to guard the Word of God? How's he going to? The same way that Paul did. Paul relied upon the Holy Spirit. So now, verse 15. This you know, that all in Asia have turned away from him. Could you imagine? All in Asia have turned away from him. And we think, right? This is talking about when Paul was in, right? He's arrested. 2 Timothy is moments before his execution. This is his last moments, right? He says, all have turned away from you. What does he mean? He means that when he was going, arrested, 2 Timothy explains this, when he was going to trial, when he was on trial, he had to give a defense, nobody stood with him. Nobody backed him up, right? He talks about that in chapter 4. He says, all in Asia have turned away from me. Could you imagine that? The people that you discipled, you raised up, you trained up, they walked away from you. And it happens, right? Betrayal, right? Everyone's looking at him and saying, man, he can't be set apart by the Lord, right? He can't be. I mean, what he did got him in trouble, right? They turned away. All that turned away from me, notice he says, Phygellus and Hermogenes. This you know, that all who in Asia have turned away from me, among whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. So these guys, they were with Paul, they were riding with Paul, and then when stuff got hard, when he was arrested, these guys, they bailed on him. They left him. He's going to talk later on in chapter 4, he's going to say a man named Demas as well. He forsook him. Demas, he left. He went to Thessalonica. He had the love of the world. So he's going to make a comparison now. He was talking in chapter 1. He says, Timothy, be strong. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. Be faithful. And he's going to say, these two guys, they weren't faithful, right? Hermogenes and Phygellus, these guys weren't faithful. But notice he gives an example of someone who was faithful. Verse 16, the Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus. This guy was faithful. You see the comparison he's making? These two guys bailed. This guy, he came, and what did he do? The Lord grant mercy to the house of Onesiphorus, for he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. Verse 17. But when he arrived in Rome, he sought me out very zealously and found me. Imagine this guy in his court. Paul's in jail. He's in a dungeon. He's being held, and he's on death row, basically. This guy, Onesiphorus, travels to Rome and is going from place to place, zealously searching out the Apostle Paul. Where is he? Where is he? And some suspect that because of Luke's ties, being a doctor, Luke was able to get access for Onesiphorus into the dungeon, to be with him, to care for him. Notice what he says, he refreshed me. He was not ashamed of my chains. And some even suspect that Paul says, you know, may the Lord be with his household. It's because Onesiphorus was probably killed. He probably died. Could you imagine that? Like coming alongside the Apostle Paul, not being ashamed of his chains, even if it meant harm coming upon him as well. He searched for me very zealously and found me. Verse 18, the Lord grant mercy unto him that he may find mercy from the Lord in that day. And you know very well how many ways he ministered to me at Ephesus. Two examples. These guys, Phygellus, Hermogenes, they departed. They walked away. They were ashamed. They were fearful. They feared something coming back at them. They left the calling of God upon their life. But this guy, Onesiphorus, he was faithful to the end. Now this is Paul's point. Now what are you going to do, Timothy? What are you going to do, Timothy? This is what he's going to talk about. Could you imagine? We only know of one sentence in the New Testament about these men's lives. What do we know about Phygellus and Hermogenes? They were traitors to the Apostle Paul. How would you like that? Phygellus and Hermogenes? Oh yeah, those are the dudes that stabbed the dude in the back. Yeah. What do you think of when you think of Judas? That dude was a real good account? Nah. You're like, that dude walked away. That guy Demas, that guy walked away. That's all you know about him. One sentence. What do we know about Onesiphorus? One sentence. He refreshed the Lord. He refreshed the Apostle Paul. He was a friend that was faithful to the end. That's all we know about him. If there was one sentence written about our lives, what would it be? What will it be when it's all said and done? What's the one sentence that they'll say about your life? I don't know. Traitor or true, right? Traitor or true? I hope true, right? To the faithful to the end. Seeing how hard it was to stand in times of trial, he says this, chapter 2, verse 1. Seeing how difficult it was, chapter 2, verse 1. You, therefore, my son, Timothy, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. How is Timothy going to do this? How is he going to succeed the ministry of the Apostle Paul? How is he going to go on and be faithful? protect the word of God? How was he going to go and be a faithful minister? It's through Christ and the grace that he supplies. That's the only way, guys. It's the only way we're going to do this ministry. He says this, he says, be strong. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The word be strong, it's actually be strengthened. So it's like a passively. So you need to receive strength. Be strengthened, right? You can't tell a Christian, be strong, right? That's worldly wisdom, right? Yeah, we can do this. Yeah, American, not American, right? Mexican, right? We can do this. No, you can't, right? That's what you learn in Christianity. You can't do it, right? He says, be strengthened. But it's continual. Being strengthened. Constantly be in this place of being strengthened, receiving strength by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. This is that enabling grace, that empowering grace. People should look upon your life and see the grace of God. I like it when Barnabas, he traveled to Antioch, and there's this explosion, revival taking place in Antioch. And what does it say Barnabas saw? He says, Barnabas saw the grace of God, and he was glad. Grace evident, grace displayed. Wow, God is at work in this place. God is at work in this man's life, this woman's life. Timothy, the only way you're going to be faithful in the ministry is grace. But not just grace, right? Not just grace. Grace that is in Christ Jesus. You want grace? Depend on Christ. Not just grace, not just favor, not just blessing, not just power. And that's how we pray, right? That's how I pray. God, strengthen me for the day. God, help me today. God, yes. Yes, that's true, but remember, Jesus is the I am. You need grace? Come to Jesus. He is grace. He is. What do you need, son? I need grace. I am. That's what he would say to you. I am. I need power. I am. I need help. I am. Come to the throne room. Come to the throne of grace. Find help in time of need. That's what Hebrews says. Come to him. Dependence upon Jesus. That's the only way you're going to be a good minister of the gospel. That's the only way you're going to walk out your calling. Whether it's here, whether it's there, wherever it is. That's the only way you're going to make disciples. It's through dependence upon Christ and the grace that he supplies. Verse 2. And here's the hammer right here. Verse 2. And the things which you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. That's the charge. That's how we're going to make disciples. That's how we're going to fulfill the Great Commission. Timothy, you find faithful men. Faithful ones. Faithful. Trustworthy. Why? Because Paul was doing something. He was depositing the word of God to Timothy. He saw that Timothy was faithful, reliable. He would go forward. Now Timothy has to have this ministry to go and to find faithful men. Faithful women. The word is faithful. It's anthropos. It's men or women. Find them. And what are you going to do? You're going to teach them. Everything you received, now give them. Does that sound like what you can do? Does that sound like a pastoral ministry? Does that sound, I don't care what you call it. I have a ministry opportunity for you, waiting for you when you get back home. Make disciples. Does it need to be a church-sanctioned thing? Tuesday discipleship class, I don't care. Call it whatever you want it. Do it at Dairy Queen, it doesn't matter. Like, make disciples. Hey, we're gonna go through this. Hey, would you care meeting up? And the cool thing, you guys are all 20, right? Yeah. The high school kids, they're like, man, I just want to hang out with somebody. Wow. Hatteras, North Carolina, like, what's up, baby? You went to California? Wow. You know, you're pulling people in, right? Now, you can either draw people to yourself or you can draw them to Jesus. faith-filled, you could translate faith-filled, or trustworthy, we could say. Guys, this is multiplication. This is finding one, and notice it says this, faithful men who will be able to teach others also. So it went from Paul, went from Jesus, went to Paul. Paul taught Timothy, right? We have that account, right? Acts 16, right? Timothy. And imagine what Paul has, right? Paul was, he was stoned in Lystra. That's the place where they beat him with stones. They thought he was dead, right? And then one day he's traveling through Lystra and the elders are like, hey, this guy Timothy? What does the name Timothy mean? Honoring to God. Honoring to God. You want to raise people up? Start there. You want to find a faithful man or woman? Find someone who's wanting to honor God. Invest. Invest. Give all that you can. Give them the word of God. Teach them. But also take them. Take them with you, right? 1 Corinthians 11:1. Imitate me as I imitate Christ also. Follow me as I follow Christ. That's what you're doing, right? That's what Jesus said. Hey, Matthew, let's go. Leave that tax stuff behind. Let's go. Follow me. And that's an aspect of your discipleship. You're going to take people along with you. You're going to live life with them. You're going to be teaching them the word of God. Think about this. You've been here for a year, just saturated. Boom, 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 boom. And now you go back. Give it out. Give it out. How many people have been blessed with the type of biblical education like you? Very few. Think about amongst the world. Even just go somewhere like Mexico or El Salvador. No biblical foundation, but big fervency, big love for God. Make disciples. Teach them. Teach them what? Teach them to observe all that I've commanded you. All. Teach them to observe that. Right? Entrust it to them. What are they going to do? They're going to go and teach others also. And they're going to go and teach others also. And they're going to, imagine that. Investment. Think of the legacy, the long-lasting legacy of Christ. Long after you're gone, the word of God is still going to be making disciples. Understand? This word is eternal. I like it that it's like, hey, Timothy, take these things, these same things. No new things. You don't need new things. You don't need to be slick, right? You don't need the newest, latest iPhone 12, iPhone 20. Right? You don't need that type of upgrade for the Bible. You don't need it. It's the same things. The same things that Paul taught Timothy is the same things that we have today. You're only here because of 2 Timothy 2:2. You understand that? Someone made a disciple who made a disciple who made a disciple who made a disciple. And someone came to America who made a disciple, and that's how you're here, right? Someone made a disciple. Someone passed the baton to you. Someone passed the torch to you. Now it's your job to teach others also. Stop waiting for the appointment of man. Stop waiting for this, you know. Obviously, you know, you can work with your pastors. Hey, pastor, this is what I feel like calling. Hopefully, he just gives you the thumbs up. He's like, go for it, man. Go for it. Any pastor, the pastor that sent you here, he went to him and said, hey, I just want to make disciples in our community. I'm not looking, I'm not asking, right? It's awkward when you go back home, right? They're going to ask me to share. I'm out. Thanks, baby. It's awkward when you go back, right? They're going to ask me to just, don't need to be asked. For it. You were trained, teach others also. You've been entrusted, invest with what you've been given. Invest. grab three, share the gospel, invite people, they believe, disciple them, right? Reach the lost, now establish those that are saved, right? Teach them, biblical foundation. Hey, how do you know you're saved? Hey, you might even go through a book together. Hey, let's meet up every other week, and hey, I'm gonna send you sermons. Do you listen to them, you know? Get them, you know, walking, get them understanding. Guys, know your calling. This is your calling. What am I called to do? I don't know. All right, the opportunity may change, right? What you're saying is, I need an opportunity. Why? Because I don't know where I'm going to go next month. The school's going to be over soon. I don't know where I'm going to go. You're looking for an opportunity. That can come like that, guys. But you need to know your calling. Whether you're working in a factory, whether you're in Nepal with me, wherever you're at, I know my calling. I'm going to make disciples. I'm going to preach the gospel. I'm going to teach. Doesn't matter where you go. You're going to work at a convenience store. All right, make disciples where you're at. Don't we need lights in this world? Don't we need salt in this world? Oh, I'm going to be a doctor. Okay, be a doctor for the glory of God. Make disciples where you're at. Right? That's what God's called us to do. That's your calling. Opportunity may change. I don't feel necessarily like a calling to Nepal or India or to Pakistan. I have a calling to make disciples, to fulfill the Great Commission. Wherever that door opens, I'm going to go. COVID, what are you going to do? You can't go back. Well, all right, well, opportunity with CBI, yeah, I'm down. Like, come on, like, opportunities. And if you do that long enough, you're going to see fruit. It's the grace that God supplies through Jesus Christ. It's the Holy Spirit that enables that work. It's not us, it's God through us, right? Know your calling. God's going to open ministry opportunities for you. You don't need men's approval. Don't seek a position. Right? You don't need a position to do that. Go anywhere. As you go, right? Jesus says, go, make disciples. Invest in other people's lives. What you've been given, invest that now. That deposit now, invest that to other people. Guys, I want to pray for you now that you would be able to now go out. Start plowing, start planting, start watering, start harvesting. Go to the Lord of the harvest, Jesus, and he's going to put you to work. Guys, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. What's my calling? Labor for the kingdom of God. Enter into the harvest field. Where do I go? Don't worry about that. Where am I going to go? Wherever opportunities open up for you. Wherever the door opens, I'm going to go. Doors closed? Cool. I'm going to go make disciples. The harvest is plentiful. The laborers are few. This is the legacy that we need to leave for Christ. You know, in the Jews, they had a mandate in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It was, teach your children, right? You guys remember that passage? As you're walking by the, you know, as you're walking, you hold their hands, teach them. That was part of the Jewish law. Teach your children, right? Disciple your children. But as you come now through the Exodus, you come now, right, parting the Red Sea, right, all these miracles. And after Moses' generation leaves, and Joshua comes down. Now Joshua's a bad dude. He's taking over the land of Canaan. Teach your children, right? Be training them, right? You know what happens in the book of Judges, chapter 2? The book of Judges, chapter 2, it says, after the generation of Joshua, the people of Israel no longer knew who the Lord was. Mm-hmm. That means let's see, a generation after taking the land, a generation after Jericho falling, they're like, Yahweh, who's that? We don't know the Lord, nor do we follow the Lord. Why? Because they weren't making disciples. Mm-hmm. Understand? It's biblical. Old Testament, New Testament. It's the same principle. Teach others that will teach others also. We are to know the Lord, glorify Him, take the gospel wherever we go, and make disciples where we're at. That's how we're going to win the world for Christ. Amen? Mm-hmm. All right. You guys are very hungry. What are we eating for lunch today? What's going on?
I think it's
buffalo all beans.
Let's pray. Let's pray. God, we're so thankful. So thankful for your word, Lord. So thankful for the time that we have together, Lord. And I know that, Lord, now that you'll take these things. My prayer is that now we would wrestle. As Jacob wrestled with you, Lord, we pray that we would too wrestle. Wrestle to the point where we are fully surrendered. Wrestle to the point where we give up. Wrestle to the point where we quit and join the winning team. We join your team, Lord. We want your will to be done. Use us for your name. Use us for your glory, God, we pray. Take us, Lord, places and to depths, Lord, that we never thought, Lord. Open up doors, I pray. Lord, I know that there's so many here struggling with today with the issue of faith. And sometimes unbelief can so cloud what we're able to do, what you're able to do. I can't go because I don't have, or I don't know, and all these things, all these questions, all these doubts. Lord, I pray that, God, this last couple of days or however long we have left of this college, Lord, I pray that we would build our faith. You would build that faith, Lord, to trust you, to not worry about tomorrow, but to seek first the kingdom of God and your righteousness. And all these things will be added unto us. But that if we live for the kingdom, that if we live for your glory, God, and your righteousness, God, you're going to provide for us, Lord. Help us now, Lord, to submit, Lord, to surrender. Your will be done. Your kingdom advance, Lord. Use us, Lord, to take the gospel out everywhere we go, from the neighbors to the nations, Lord. I pray, Lord, just a blessing, Lord, upon this class. Lord, would you cause the fellowship to be so sweet, Lord? Cast out any distraction, Lord, from what you're doing here. Cause the fire in their heart to burn so bright for Christ, Lord. I pray that we would hunger and thirst for righteousness.